Yes. So the last paragraph of Canto 2, Book 1, page number 21. This truth broke in a triumph of fire. A victory was won for God in man. The deity revealed its hidden face. The great world mother now in her arose. A living choice reversed fate's cold, dead turn. Affirmed the spirit's tread on circumstance. Pressed back the senseless, dire, revolving wheel. And stopped the mute march of necessity. A flaming warrior from the eternal peaks, empowered to force the door denied and closed, smote from death's visage its dumb absolute, and burst the bounds of consciousness and time. So Savitri now is getting touched in within her with this Godhead who is behind the mechanics of the nature. You know, the light of consciousness that is not manifested, you know, that is not very, very obvious, but it is obvious beneath the workings of all the machinery and all the mechanics. So this Godhead was now in touch with Savitri. Savitri got in touch with this divine light that is present with each one of us, present in each one of us. And this truth that, yes, a Godhead is there, a tremendous strength is there beneath the workings of the nature. This truth broke in a triumph of fire. This, like, you know, came as a revelation for Savitri. A victory was won for God in man. Why a victory? Because with this strength, with the strength of infinite connected with us, we can achieve miracles, you know, as was said earlier, a prayer, a master act, a king's idea can link a man's strength to that infinite force, to that infinite strength. And that's why Sri Aurobindo here is already declaring that this mission for which Savitri is now embarking upon, it'll already be Savitri's victory. You know, it's already kind of a pre-declaration, kind of a direct hint that this victory is already, this is a certitude, this is going to happen, because nothing can come on the way of man when man is directly in touch with the divine, with the divinity within him. As Kabir says, Ram mile thane kaun hatke. The one who finds Ram within, no one can stop him. No one can stop him. Nothing can stop him on the mission. And that's why a victory was won for God in man. The deity revealed its hidden face. You know, why hidden face? Because beneath all our challenges, beneath all our darkest most phases, lies this light of the divine. Pick up each single one of the phase that we go through in as human beings. Pick up each and every dark emotion that we feel as a human being. Pick up as bad a phase that we go through as a human being. In the depths of those phases lies this, you know, the one who is hiding behind this creation. Because it's his leela that first I will hide and then it's fun to kind of find me out. You know, the joy of progress, the joy of revelations, the joy of coincidences. That's why we are here. So now what happens with Savitri is now kind of confronted with the Godhead within Savitri. The deity revealed its hidden face. And this gives us so much of strength, because then once we, you know, once we remember that, yes, behind every play of our life, each and every phase of our life is hiding the one only, is hiding Krishna only, is hiding the divine only, then why would we fear any phase in our life? No matter how dire it may seem. Why would I fear any disease For example, why would I fear any sickness, any illness, any dark patch in my life? Because beneath every darkness lies hidden the divine only. It's his play. So can I just allow myself to go out as, you know, like the stumbling block I become many a times, most of the times, you know? Can I allow myself to step aside so that the divine play can manifest in its fullness? The great world mother now in her arose. You know, she connected with the strength, the divinity, the mission that she was here to accomplish. She connected with the deep strength there, with her own origins in a deeper manner. A world mother, why a world mother? Because the god of love is now to make this person her house, you know, his house. That's why it was said that in her being, in her mortal being, the god of love found his own home. That yes, I can work from this instrument. She is pure enough that I can use her as a channel of spreading love and more love. Because love is the only thing that has the transformative power that can make things move. The divine love. So the great world mother now in her arose. A living choice reversed fate's cold dead turn. You know, she chose this. You know, later on also in further, I think book 7 or book 9, we will see that Savitri also goes through human emotions of feeling a loss, feeling grief and pain. And yet using that pain as a dagger, she goes deep within and connects with the depths of strength, divine strength, that helps her go forward in her mission. So that's her choice that she is making, that yes, I can fall a trap to the frustration of my robbed plans and dreams with Satyavan. I can fall easily a prey to that. Yet I choose something else. So there is a choice. There is a choice that Savitri is making, a living choice, reversed fate's cold, dead turn. She refused to admit to frustration. You know, when one goes through, when plans in our life fail. Okay, this plan has failed. No matter, you know, one goes on in full joy and light because there must be some reason why this plan has failed. So let's find it out. You know, let's discover like an adventurer. So that's her living choice. Affirmed the spirit's tread on circumstance. Now, this living choice that she made, it made an affirmation that yes, the spirit within the being can tread, can use the circumstance as a means to progress. And we can all do that in our own accord, in our own capacities. What is written here, what is true for Savitri, is true for each one of us. In whatever capacity we become available to these truths of life. And that is why Mother has said that the more we begin to experience our life intimately, go through its movements more closely in consciousness, then the words of Savitri become alive for us in that much of degrees. You know, the more we experience in life, and we see that some of the lines are more truer than the others at the moment. Because one has experienced that. It is our own human life. So the spirit can now use the circumstance. It can tread on the circumstance for as a stepping stone. And this pressed back the senseless, dire revolving wheel and stopped the mute march of necessity. You know, that law of, okay, the plans have failed. Now one has to go through the guilt, the frustration. So that is as if it feels like it is a blind necessity. One is living in ignorance. So if the plans fail, one is surely to go down in the dumps and go through guilt, shame and victimhood and all that. But that's not true. We all have free will at each moment of life. Many a times we are not able to see that, yes, I have free will. But as our circumstances go forward, as I begin to experience more and more of life experiences, I become more as a conscious being, I become alive to the fact that yes, I do have this free will. And yes, it's not that the pain is not there. It's not that the plans have not failed. Yet, there is still a choice that I have. What do I choose? You know, whenever we become capable of looking at this choice, it's never too late. It's never too late to use that choice consciously to take ahead our life in a right manner, whatever feels right for each one of us. And then the wheels of karma, you know, the law of duality doesn't have to go on and on and on and on. It can stop. The mute march of necessity, the blind conventions can then stop, and I can begin a natural unfoldment of my inner truth. You know, kind of looking into an uncharted territory. Now, a flaming warrior from eternal peaks, empowered to force the door denied and closed, the door of divinity, the door of divine strength, which is usually in day-to-day life, we feel that as if it's not available to us, the door of divine connection. Now this flaming warrior, the warrior that Savitri is, full of this flame, intensity of progression, a flaming warrior from eternal peaks. Now she's empowered. The moment she connects with the divinity within, she is empowered to force the door, which is so far denied and so far closed, smote from death's visage, its dumb absolute. Smote is coming from this word called smite, smitten, you know. And smote means that now she strikes heavily on the death's mask, which feels like an absolute necessity. You know, it feels like it's an absolute mask. Nothing can change death. Yet it's only a mask. Death is just playing a game. Like it's a mask of the divine only. And no matter how hard and harsh and stone-eyed it may seem, this can be broken. One can see behind the mask what is there. So she takes this big hammer. You know, I'll show you this image of mother, which mother made a sketch of herself when she, she had a vision that I was standing in front of this door of the supermind, the golden light, and there was this closed door. I took a hammer in my hand and then made a strike, very, very heavy strike, and the flood of the divine strength, supermind, poured down on earth. On 20th Feb 1956, mother has made a sketch. I'll just show you in a while. So this flaming warrior from eternal peaks, now empowered to force the door denied and closed so far, smote from death's visage its dumb absolute, that the mask of this dumbness, the mask of this stone-eyed law that nothing can change death, this was kind of, you know, mother was able to strike it off, that no, you can also change. It's just a mask. And burst the bounds of consciousness and time. So let me just show you this image that mother has made on these lines only of Savitri. I'll just share the screen again. Yes, I hope you can all see that. So this is the sketch that mother made of these lines. A flaming warrior from eternal peaks, empowered to force the door denied and closed, smote from death's visage its dumb absolute and burst the bounds of consciousness and time. This is the sketch by the mother of how she was able to break this door on 20th Feb 1956, which is also recognized as the day when Supermind came to Earth. It is present on Earth right now. It's a living reality. And that's why I think one of the reasons why more and more of us are turning towards the light, more and more of us are turning, going through crossroads in our lives and waking up to the reality that there is something more to life than just waking, sleeping, eating, and you know, going about the daily chores. There is something more to it, and that's one of the reasons that the supermind is in action. Now, what is supermind? We'll not go there because it's a very, very big issue in itself. For those of us who are inclined, they can always search it online. There is enough material available that what is supermind, and we are actually moving towards it only. And even if we don't know, it's just a movement towards the supermind only. Yeah. Yes.
The last canto of Savitri, no?
Yes.
That that denotes the total supermind.
Yeah. Yes. So far it was just the day that was going on, and now begins the flashback. So now from page number 22 to I think page number 561 is the flashback of all events that have led to Savitri's birth, that have led to Savitri meeting Satyavan, the conversation of Narad with the parents of Savitri, and all that. You know, that goes on from page number 22 now, Canto 3, Book 1, to page 561. And that is what we are going to embark upon now. Maybe we'll just go through the first few lines here today, Canto 3. If there is anything, just feel free to share in between. Yeah. Yes, so book one, still the book of beginnings, Canto 3, the yoga of the king. King Ashwapati, Savitri's father, the yoga of the soul's release. Yes, who would like to read?
Monica, the page 561 that you mentioned, that also says Canto 3, but it has like something on it like the 1. And this one is also Canto 3.
नहीं, वो कैंटो थ्री होगा, बट द बुक वुड बी डिफरेंट ना. सो देर इज लाइक बुक वन कैंटो वन कैंटो टू कैंटो थ्री, देन बुक टू कैंटो वन कैंटो टू कैंटो थ्री. आई थिंक द वन दैट यू आर रेफरिंग टू, दैट वॉज रिटन वेरी मच बिफोर ऑल दीज कैंटोज, एंड दे हैवंट चेंज्ड. श्री अरविंदो डिड नॉट चेंज द नंबरिंग ऑफ द कैंटो. सो इफ आई एम नॉट रॉन्ग, इट इज बीइंग केप्ट कैंटो थ्री ओनली द नेम. या
A world's desire compelled her mortal birth, one in the front of the immemorial quest, protagonist of the mysterious play in which the unknown pursues himself through forms and limits his eternity by the hours. And the blind void struggles to live and see, a thinker and toiler in the ideal's air, brought down to earth's dumb need, her radiant power.
Yes. So this is a reference to how a divine descent happens. You know, there has to be a lot of suffering first. Somehow the world is made that way. A lot of pain is needed. A lot of struggle is needed, because the journey is from the inconscient to the conscience. And just like how we give birth, you know, we females, we are aware of it. There is a lot of process that goes on. There is pain, there is labor pains. So we in human evolution, we have been going through these labor pains of birthing ourselves, you know, of birthing a newer and newer and newer humanity. We have been continually in these labor pains. And that is why pain becomes a necessity for birth. That is how even the nature is designed. You know, we see animals giving birth, we see human beings giving birth. It's only through pain that a new birth happens. somehow that is also an indicator to how a new birth in humanity will happen. So the pain at present is, however, the structure of universe is there, the structure of humanity is there. At present, it is a necessity, right? A world's desire compelled her mortal birth. There is so much suffering in conscience. There is so much suffering and pain that the human beings and in general, you know, creatures go through, especially the mankind, because at the level of the mankind only, this urge to move on, the urge to find and connect with the divine essence is there. It's not there as the at the level of animals. It's only there, it comes at the level of human beings. And that's why, again and again, it has been said that humanity is something special. Although we may not use its speciality when we are alive, but yet it is special. Human birth is a special birth given to us so that we can take this progress towards divinity, towards our fullness of consciousness in an exponential manner. You know, like a collaboration is happening. Earlier, it's only nature that we are following, the nature of a plant, the nature of an animal. We are only following nature. But here, when we are born as a human being, we have that capacity to come out of the nature, you know, be something more than our just nature, you know, connect to the origin that we are coming from. And that's why I would say that Sumiran, you know, a remembrance has been given so much of focus in from saints, mystics, and even poems of mystics, that remember who you truly are. When I'm going through a feeling, when I'm going through a thought, when I'm going through a dark challenge, if I take a moment to remember the vastness that I am, I would say, oh, if I am the vastness, then I can go through this dark challenge also. And that's how we allow things to happen, that if I am the vastness, if I am coming from the divine origins, then why can't I go through this feeling also? The feeling can stay in the being as long as it wants. I don't have to fight with the feeling. I don't have to fight with the thoughts that are there, because I am something beyond the thoughts. I am much more than thoughts and feelings and the body. And that's how I connect with the deeper strength that I am. So this desire of moving on and connecting to our deepest essence, the call from ascending soul, this is the desire that compelled Savitri's mortal birth. One in the front of immemorial quest, a quest that has been coming since centuries. That's why I posted the song that I posted on the Doha group today, you know, Avadhuta Yugan Yugan Ham Yogi. We don't even know since when we have been toiling to achieve this kind of more and more union with our own true selves, to shed the walls of obscurity, to remember who we truly are and work from there. One in the front of the immemorial quest. Now, Ashwapati, the king, has been referred to the leader of humanity. So as if he is representing what humanity is at the moment. He is representing the call of humanity to the divine. One in the front of the immemorial quest. One doesn't even know when this quest started, of this this wanting to unite truly with our essence, you know, to shed off all the walls of obscurity. One doesn't even know when it started. Protagonist of the mysterious play, you know, as if he is the sutradhar, he is the main actor, the main lead of this mysterious play of divinity, the leela of divinity. What is the play? Then Sri Aurobindo describes the play itself, in which the unknown, with capital U, in which the unknown pursues himself through forms. A play, you know, a leela. He is hiding and he is trying to find himself. Who are we to bother in between? And the moment I remember this, that it's his play and he is the one who is hiding and seeking, a little bit of burden is shed off immediately. the moment I remember this true, you know, the essence why we are here, in which the unknown, agay, you know, that which cannot be known, no matter how many names we may give him, we cannot talk about him. The moment I talk about him, I put him into a structure. So it's better not to talk about him. That which cannot be known, that is beyond the mind, beyond our knowing. And that's why mind fails in front of, you know, when we confront ourselves with the challenge of kind of addressing divinity or expressing divinity, we fail again and again. Yet words have their own value, they kind of act as a pointer, in which the unknown pursues himself. So he is the one who has created the veil. He is the one who is pursuing himself, wanting to become conscious out of that inconscience. Where do we come into picture? If we just look at it, where do I come into picture? As if I am the stumbling block in this play, you know, because I have this story about myself that this has been my life story and this must manifest out in its fullness. And that story becomes again and again like a burden on my head. And there is also these lines from a song, you know, khud khud kooza gar, khud gile kooza. You are the one which is the clay. You are the one who is making the clay. And you are the one what is made out of the clay. So, kumhar bhi tum hi ho, clay bhi tum hi ho. Bartan bana wo bhi tum hi ho. Khud gile kuza. You are the clay of which everything is formed. So this is the mysterious play, the leela of the divine, in which the unknown pursues himself through forms and limits his eternity by the hours. You know, he is timeless, he is eternal, yet he is agreed to come into this limited form. And that's why I find it very, very interesting that there are moments in our lives where when we are deeply, deeply aware and able to touch our depths, those moments appear like as if I have lived an eternity in a limited frame of time. It feels that in 10 minutes of a time, I have touched the depths which were beyond time. Now, I find it very, very interesting, this thing of timelessness contained within the time. It's very beautiful. You know, I'm sure all of us have touched those moments in our lives. So the limits, so the unknown is limiting his eternity, limiting his timelessness by the hours. It's like a consent that he has made that, yes, for this play, I will do that. And the blind void struggles to live and see. The void, the void that we talked of in the first canto, one of book one, the symbol dawn, you know, this dumbness, the fathomless zero, as if it's trying to now become conscious of itself, as if there is some rigidity in me, which is now mellowing down, becoming more and more light and conscious of itself. You know, that is the very play. So how can we say that? What is the need to become guilty of that rigidity? What is the need to become shameful of our own darknesses and weaknesses? Because that is the very play. That is the very play that I will have weaknesses and then I will find my strength through those weaknesses. And I will see that weaknesses and strength are contained as if in a much, much, much vaster space that we are. So they are all welcome. They are all allowed. The play is welcome. And the blind void struggles to live and see. A thinker and toiler in ideal's air, referring to Ashwapati, you know, that he is the leader as if of this humanity, and he's the thinker, the leader and toiler. He will prepare the ground. He will toil the mud and earth, so that the seeds of divinity, the seeds of immortality, the seeds of a new human race are kind of put on in that soil. Brought down to earth's dumb need, her radiant power. Now earth's nature is dumb, has been referred to as, there is a dumbness in there, there's an ignorance in there, and it cannot express what it is it may be craving for. So the earth may be craving for light, but the owing to the fact that it is nature, it is profoundly dumb in its capacity. Ashwapati is as if translating earth's need to move towards more and more light and more power and strength. So Ashwapati is the leader who will express earth's need for consciousness. He will be leading mankind. Yes, anything so far?
Monica, how do we know this is about Ashwapati? You might have said it, but I missed it. I'm sorry.
How do we know? We just know that from the interpretation so far, which have been discussed, because I only kind of reflect and also understand those interpretations. So far what I have read and understood is that Ashwapati is the one who is leading, as if because he will be calling down the Divine Mother for the help of humanity. So that's why I know that it's a reference to Ashwapati. Yeah. And again, touching upon that aspect, that although it is Ashwapati that is referred to, yet Ashwapati is in all of us, just like Savitri is in all of us. And all the, all these kind of aspects can be seen in each one of us. These are human aspects. So we are human, yet we are beyond human in our capacities. So also would like to point out there. Yeah. Yes. Who would like to read?
His was a spirit that stooped from larger spheres into our province of ephemeral sight, a colonist from immortality, a pointing beam on earth's unseeing roads. His birth held up a symbol and a sign, his human self like a translucent clock, covered the wise who led the unseeing world.
Yes. So Ashwapati was a spirit, his was a spirit, although he had this human form, just like Savitri, we heard the mention, we read about it, that Savitri had a human form, she agreed to have a human form, but she is very well connected, she knows her divine origins. And that's why there is so much stress on remembrance of Sumiran, of who we are truly, because we all are actually divine in nature, and we forget why we are here. We think that we are this human nature, we are these tendencies, we are these vrittis that play out themselves, but we are much, much, much beyond than all that. And that's why in the midst of challenges and in the midst of crisis, our beyond human aspects come out, which mostly are masked in the day-to-day mechanics of life. So Ashwapati's spirit was a spirit that stooped from larger spheres. If you remember, we also read a line in describing about Savitri, that Savitri stooped from the heavens, to help the humanity. She came down, took the mortal birth. Just like that, it's also a mention regarding Ashwapati. And for each one of us, we have agreed to take a human form for some reason, but we forget. We forget, and this forgetfulness on one hand is very, very important, because otherwise we'll be having all the burden of the past lives in our head. So forgetfulness is there for a reason also, and also to rediscover myself again and again, anew, afresh. This forgetfulness is very, very important. So that also has its own purpose. Yet remembrance also has its own purpose, because if I am not in touch with the remembrance of who I truly am, then I keep on living as if I am the mind, I am the thoughts, I am the feelings, I am the body. And I feel very, very suffocated there. And it's a part of me, it's fleeting and going, yet I am something much, much more than that. So I can allow that to happen and go on still in my life. So this kind of a remembrance comes again and again, you know, that one has to kind of keep on remembering who we truly are. His was a spirit that stooped from larger spheres into our province of ephemeral sight. Earth, you know, the earthly realm, human time, it appears like 80 years, 90 years. For us, it appears like a long time. But if we look from the point of eternity, it's nothing but a blink of an eye, even less than that. So all is actually shanbhangur, as we say, you know, just like there is this moth which goes towards the flame and is burnt in the flame. Within a matter of a day or hours, it is burnt. That's how ephemeral our life is. But for us, it appears like it's a long life. But if we look from the level of eternity, from the level of timelessness, it's actually a very, very short, fleeting moment in the whole of eternity. Into our province, referring to earth, into our province of ephemeral sight, where everything is fleeting, everything is changing, it's just a matter of time. There, a colonist from immortality, Ashwapati is referred to as a colonist, as if he has come to colonize immortality. So far we live in a mortal domain, we see that people are dying and everything is happening, everything is changing. But he dares to bring immortality, to create a colony of immortality on this place called Earth, where everything appears to be just a passing game, you know, fleeting, non-permanent. There he wants to have this colony of immortality. A kind of a new race has to come, for which he is working. A pointing beam on earth's uncertain roads. His birth held up a symbol and a sign. So Ashwapati refers to a symbol and a sign. He points to something different on the uncertainty that is present on earth. We don't even know our next step. We may think that I have created a bank account, I am going to live 40, 30, 60 years. But are we sure? We are not sure. So life is extremely uncertain on earthly domain. It's a dangerous, precarious field, as we read earlier when the reference was to Savitri. Yet he refers or he hints at something which is beyond all this uncertainty. His life is a symbol, his life is a sign pointing towards something which all of us have, our divine origins, which is in touch with that immortality, with that certitude that who we are can never die and can never be born. So what is the fear? Now, can that light, can that immortality manifest itself more and more in fullness? That is the mission what Ashwapati is embarking upon. So he is pointing, you know, just like avatars and messengers and messihas and saints and mystics, they give us pointers towards something. You know, their words appear so beautiful to us because they are pointing towards something which is more than earthly existence. What is that? Can that be actually manifested on earth in its fullness? His human self like a translucent cloak. So although this human self covers the soul that we are, as if we are hiding our light in this blanket of human body that I have taken, as if I am hiding my limitlessness in the limited frame that I have taken. Yet, all of us, in whatever capacities we can, we shine our light. There is this shine in our light, in our, you know, eyes, that comes through our being. That shine is the shine of our souls. That shine is the shine of our spirits. many a times, most of the times, it's mostly obscured, it's distorted. Yet, still, we remember the spark that the person was. We always remember when we lose our loved ones in our, you know, in earthly existence. We remember the life spirit that they indicated. And that life spirit shines through us, each one of us. So his human form, his human self was like a translucent cloak, not completely opaque. It's translucent. It is as if, you know, like there is a curtain which is a very, very delicate thin curtain. And if sunlight is shining through it, there is much, much light that comes out because the curtain is very translucent. While if it's a wall, the light is not able to much pass through. So that's how Ashwapati was, that his human self is more like a translucent cloak. One can see the spirit shining behind. Covered the all-wise who leads the unseeing world. We may not even know in what matters we are directed in our lives. We may not even know the exact path in our life, yet we all are directed. The degrees may be greater or lower. You know, the more the ego sheds its pieces, the more the ego dissolves and become more like a thin curtain, then the degree of the manifestation of that all-wise one becomes greater and greater. Yet, all of us are guided by that force within us. All of us are kind of, you know, in our oblivion, we are guided by that all-wise which has covered himself within us only. So that's a reference to his human self, human body, that the human self covered the all-wise. It was hiding the all-wise who leads the unseeing world. In oblivion, I don't even know where the life events that are happening in my life are guiding me towards. You know, I don't even know. It's like an ignorant kind of a game that goes on mostly. Yeah. Yes, so maybe the last few lines, last three lines, and then I think we can call it a day. Yeah. Yes, who would like to read?
Last three lines, okay. Related to cosmic space and time, and paying here God's debt to earth, and a greater sonship was his divine right. Although consenting to mortal ignorance, his knowledge shared the light ineffable.
Yes. So Ashwapati is like a pointing beam on the earth uncertain roads, and just like all the masters that come, you know, on earth, humanity, they come for humanity, they just point us towards something which is more than what we see. And he's affiliated to cosmic space and time, as if he has a kinship with something more than earth. Affiliation, you know, when we talk about companies which are affiliated to each other, they have a connection, they have a kind of a kinship with each other. So just like that, although Ashwapati has this human earthly form, yet he is affiliated, he has a brothership to cosmic space and time. Just like we read about Savitri, that Savitri, although she had a human form, she was still connected to the ineffable. She was connected deeply to her origins. And paying here God's debt to earth and man, a greater sonship was a divine right. So God's debt, this word also appears later many times in Savitri. It's like that God has created his leela, his play, for which the origin is in delight, the origin is in joy. You know, one, for example, when we play hide and seek, when kids are playing hide and seek with their parents or someone elder, you know, we see that there may be a pain when the kid is not able to find out, you know, where you are. He may even start crying at times. Yet when he finds out, there is a joy. So that is the leela that goes on. And because in the earthly time, it appears actually a long time, these 80, 90 years or shorter of human birth, we feel that why is there so much of struggle? Why is there so much of pain? Many a times we are plunged in these dark spaces of ignorance. And there it appears as if God is trying to repay. You know, it's God's humanity, it's God's existence, it's God's leela. So it's his duty that he must be there for the humanity that he has created. So that's why, you know, this God's debt, as if God is trying to repay the debt that, yes, this is my leela, I am there for you, and you are not there alone in this leela. You know, don't think that you are alone, because owing to the mind, we begin into this thinking game that I am the only one who is suffering and God is cruel and all that, the idea of separation. So that's why the messengers, the masters are sent. So in that sense, the God is trying to repay the debt that he owes to earth and man, that I am here, I am with you. Although consenting to mortal ignorance, his knowledge shared the light ineffable. So we will see, you know, in our own capacities, all of us have our challenges. All of us have our dark shadows or darknesses. Yet we also have phases of light. We also have phases where we have clarity. We are in touch with that light ineffable. So it's like more and more we become capable of harboring that light. The veils of ignorance are shed in more greater detail, and we rise above from the mortal ignorance, which we have plunged in to consciously. This is a conscious plunge that we have made, that I will first hide myself in the matter, the dumbness of the matter, and then I will evolve and try to find myself again in my truest essence. So that is the plunge that we have consented for. Although consenting to mortal ignorance, his knowledge shared the light ineffable. All of us have done this consent of plunging into that darkness and then entering into that adventure of walking from unconsciousness towards more and more consciousness. And that is what is the play, the divine play. Yes, any comments? Okay. Yes. Good then. Thanks for joining. Thank you for reading also today. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.